الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين ورحمة الله للعالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All the praise and all the glory is due to Allah, and I bear witness that there is no God but Allah and that Muhammad is his last prophet and messenger. May the blessings and peace of Allah be upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and those who followed his path of guidance up to the day of judgment. My dear respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to a new episode of explaining the ahadith or the prophetic traditions on legal rulings, commonly known as the Book of Abdul Ghani Al-Maqdisi, The Essence of Legal Rulings or Umdat Al-Ahkam. And the book under discussion is an anthology or a compilation of ahadith agreed upon by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, so they occupy the highest grades on authenticity, and they discuss the different aspects of Islamic law or Islamic fiqh. Today's hadith, we continue on the chapter on the necessity of offering obligatory prayers in jama'ah or in congregation. This is in fact hadith number 60, and it is the last hadith on this chapter. The hadith is on the authority of Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him. Let us read the text in Arabic and its translation, and then we will try to discuss some of the legal rulings included on that hadith. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أثقل الصلاة على المنافقين صلاة العشاء وصلاة الفجر ولو يعلمون ما فيهما لأتوهما ولو حبوا ولقد هممت أن آمر بالصلاة فتقام ثم آمر رجلا فيصلي بالناس ثم أنطلق معي برجال معهم حزم من حطب إلى قوم لا يشهدون الصلاة فأحرق عليهم بيوتهم بالنار. On the authority of Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, who said, the Messenger of Allah, blessings and peace of Allah be upon him, said, the most difficult prayers for the hypocrites are the Isha prayer or the evening prayer and the Fajr prayer. Had they known the reward of offering them in congregation, they would have certainly present themselves in mosques even if they had to crawl. I have resolved to command a man to pronounce iqama and another man to lead people in congregation and turn my face to people who are missed in offering the prayer in congregation to burn or to set fire in their homes. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith explains to us a number of issues. On the top of them, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives us a hint about the importance or the most important two obligatory prayers, namely the Isha and the Fajr. Mainly because those two basic prayers are actually after having a nap or a sleep. The Isha prayer is at the end of the day, when a person actually is completely exhausted after having his work, and the Fajr prayer is after sleep. So the shaitan plays and insinuates in the heart of a believer to the extent to turn him away. And even if a person has a stronger iman, he may actually miss those two prayers in congregation. And this is the spot of threatening here, according to the explanation. So the Prophet ﷺ said, only people of strong faith, belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are the ones who are supported by this iman to attend those two obligatory prayers in congregation regularly. And the hypocrites are the people who cannot actually perform them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about it in the Quran, that not only the believers who join and enjoy prayers, but actually people who taste the sweetness of khushu' in prayer. Allah said in the Quran, وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. It is so difficult, but not for the people who are khashi'een, who perform it in a state of attentiveness and in a state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The scholars relied on this hadith on understanding on the necessity of offering the Isha prayer or actually all the obligatory prayers in jama'ah. And we have three major opinions of scholars. The first group is a scholar who said that offering all obligatory prayers in jama'ah is a must. It's something which is essential. And moreover, they added the fact that the prayer is not held valid if a person cannot pray in jama'ah in mosques. And they relied on a number of ahadith. On the top of them is the hadith under discussion, the hadith of Abu Hurairah, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam threatened the Muslims of setting fire at their homes. And this is a great punishment. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of mercy, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dares to say that he is going to set fire in the homes of those people, it means that it is a very great sin. Moreover, when the blind person came to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he sought his permission not to offer the prayer in jama'ah, in congregation, simply because he cannot have a guide to guide him, and it's sometimes very windy and he cannot go to the masjid by himself. So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam permitted him first, and afterwards he called him back and said, do you hear the azan with your own ears? He said, yes, I hear it. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied and said, labbi nida Allah, or labbi hayya. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you must respond to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Afterwards, even the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not give, even those scholars relied on another hadith. This is a hadith related by Ibn Majah and Al-Hakim. And the scholar said that it has an authentic chain of narration in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the prayer is not accepted. لا صلاتة لمن لم يصلي. There is no prayer to be held valid for a person if he does not offer it in the masjid or in the mosque, except if he has a valid excuse. This is the view of the Zahiri scholars and some of them. And this is the view also of one of the variant views of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. The second view is that jama'ah is obligatory, but it does not affect the validity of the prayer. So if a person makes a jama'ah, if a person makes prayer in jama'ah, it is a must. But if he misses it and he makes it at home, his prayer is still accepted. And they relied on a number of ahadith. On the top of them, the hadith under discussion, because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he was going to leave the Muslims offer the prayer in jama'ah, and then he would turn to people who missed it to set the fire in their homes. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ready to leave the prayer for the sake of commanding good and forbidding evil. And they also relied on the other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which He said, Salatul Jama'ati afdalu min salatil fazd. Praying in Jama'ah or in congregation is superior, or is more superior than praying alone. So the scholar said that if the Prophet ﷺ compares praying alone and praying in congregation, so he said, or he tacitly approved that there is still a reward in making prayer alone. And the third opinion is that praying in Jama'ah or in the mosque is an emphatic recommendation. Sunnatun mu'akkada. Emphatically recommended by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the correct view of all those scholars is that jama'ah, or offering prayers in congregation in the mosque, is obligatory on male as long as a person does not have a valid excuse. But if a person prays at home, his prayer is still accepted, but it is far below the reward and superiority than making it in congregation. And we mentioned the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, in which he witnessed to the age of the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, وَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُنَا, I have witnessed the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, none of them misses prayer in congregation except two people. Number one, a person who is in depth of his hypocrisy, he is completely hypocrite, he is completely distracted from full iman, or a person who has an excuse. And he said, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, I saw with my own eyes the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dragging their feet on the ground, being carried by men, by strong men, to be standing in the rows of prayer. Nobody would actually miss it. And unfortunately nowadays we have some people that they do not offer the prayers in congregation. That's why we have our mosques insolvent of worshippers. Unfortunately, sometimes we find just the imam and a couple of people behind him, and the rest of Muslims offer their prayers at home. Like actually some Christians who abandon their churches and their places of worship, and they don't have any worshippers, and they actually wanted to sell their places of worship. So the sunnah, or the main way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is to offer prayers in jama'ah in mosques, and this is the established rule.
Assalamu alaikum, and welcome, dear viewers from around the world, to our exciting program titled Good Answer. I'm your host Malik, and I'm joined by the Imam of America, the founder of Guide Us TV. He needs no further introduction. I think you know who I'm talking about, Sheikh Yusuf Estes. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh Yusuf.
Assalamu alaikum, Malik.
My name is Ayman, and I think a lot of people would like to know, a lot of non-Muslims would like to know who Prophet Muhammad was.
We worship the God that he worshipped. And we worship that God the way he worshipped. So we consider Islam to be a way or a deen.
Yes.
Anywhere. But that had never been there before. He said, this is a gift, never came before, that me and my followers, we can make our salah, our connection, anywhere.
Hey, Sheikh, you're on the hot seat. I like my seat over here. I'm feeling comfortable. Because he asked you a tough question. He asked you a good question. Can you give him a good answer?
Allah mentions Arabic words in Quran 11 times. This might be a sign for us to know the importance of studying Quran and studying Arabic language, because it's the door to know more about Quran. Ubay ibn Ka'b, one of the most important Sahabas, advised the Sahaba, telling them, teach your children Arabic like you teach them to memorize Quran. See how important it was. And they are Arabs. Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, said, learn Arabic because it is part of your religion. Arabic is part of our religion. So how are we going to study Arabic and learn Arabic together in this course? This basic Arabic course contains 7 levels, starting with the 0 level, the ground level. Each level contains 13 sessions, 45 minutes each, and we have 2 quizzes in each course, and we have the final exam. So inshallah, by this, our objectives is to have a very good domain of the Arabic language, especially when it comes to reading Islamic books. So we're going to be introducing Islamic vocab throughout the course. So go ahead, please, and enroll in our basic Arabic course, as Arabic is the official language of more than 20 countries, and Arabic is the key and the door of all Islamic sciences. So please do enter this door from the correct way, Arabic language.
Huda Academy, your gateway to authentic Islamic knowledge.
From the hadith under discussion, we understand also another rule. Here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَقَدْ هَمَمْتُ أَنْ آمُرَ رَجُلًا فَيُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to command a man to announce the iqama. So the scholars concluded that iqama is a sunnah, and iqama is one of the rites of Islam. Moreover, they concluded that the only person who has the right of specifying the time of iqama is the imam, because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through his sunnah used to command Bilal, or even the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim used to stand up when they saw Bilal making iqama. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you should stand up when you see me going to jama'ah. So the scholars concluded that the worshippers stand up and they get themselves ready for making prayers in the rows once they see the imam. This is the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have a violation of this sunnah when we find some people quarrel, when the time between adhan and iqama becomes longer. Some people, they rush into making iqama, or they push the muazzin to make iqama. This is not the sunnah of the beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to give the command by himself. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to call upon the muqim or the muazzin, and he is the only person. Also, the scholars concluded from this hadith that the imam is the only person to assign who should be the imam. We have some people, they actually rush into being imams in some occasions. And in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave priorities. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the authentic hadith of Malik ibn al-Huwayrith, assigned who is most worthy to be an imam. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَأُمُّ الْقَوْمَ أَقْرَأُهُمْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. First, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam established the rule that if there is an assigned imam in the mosque, or if there is a man at his home, he must be the leader in prayer. And he should be given the priority, because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, لَا يَأُمَّنَّ الرَّجُلُ الرَّجُلَ فِي سُلْطَانِهِ وَلَا يَجْلِسْ فِي بَيْتِهِ إِلَّا وَلَا يَجْلِسْ عَلَى مَكْرُمَتِهِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person cannot lead another person in congregation at his home, at his masjid. So the assigned imam or the leader of prayer should be given the priority. If we miss the assigned or the appointed imam, scholars said that we refer to the most knowledgeable person, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ya ummul qawma aqra'uhum li kitabillah." So the scholars, they differed about who is the most knowledgeable. Is he the person who memorizes the Quran most, or the person who knows about the rights of fiqh and Islamic law and Islamic knowledge more? And according to the correct view, they said that the most knowledgeable here is the person who knows prayer, the person who knows the law, the person who is more knowledgeable about the Quran and about the explanation of the Quran and the other rites of Sharia. Why? Because sometimes there may happen a problem in the middle of the prayer. maybe he actually misses a constituent element, a rukn, or an obligatory deed in the middle of prayer, or he may actually invalidate his prayer. So he should know how to manage himself in the middle of prayer if there is an emergency happens. If they are all equal in knowledge, they must, or in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they should refer to the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he is more knowledgeable about the sunnah, should lead people in prayer. If they are all equal in the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, scholars differed. Some of them said the most elderly person should take leadership in prayer. We see a lot of people that subhanallah, they rush into being an imam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that there are three people whose prayers cannot be raised in front of their own heads, cannot be accepted. On the top of them is an imam who led the people in prayer while the rest of people hate or they dislike him being an imam. So this is a very big warning. From this hadith also we understand, is it permissible for a person or for an imam to make a penalty? Like, for example, nowadays we have financial penalties. Like if we are in the traffic law, people, if they violate the law, they must pay a compensation or they must pay a penalty in the sense of financial compensation. Scholars said that it is permissible, and this is included in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where can you find it? You can find it because the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he was going to burn or to set fire at homes of those people who missed the congregation, which means that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has a sign, a penalty of demolishing those homes or even setting fire at those homes because of the great sin those people made. And they also differed about, is it permissible for a Muslim to torture another by making or by the fire? And there is a report about Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah be pleased with him, who is reported as setting fire in some people, especially the people who worshipped him. Some people, they worshipped Ali ibn Abi Talib, so he said, I should actually set fire in them first before the fire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to afflict them. But according to the correct view, the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited setting fire, and he said, لا يعذب بالنار إلا رب النار. Only the one who sets fire in people is the Lord of the fire, which is in the hellfire, in the last day or in the hereafter. So it is abrogated. Maybe it was permitted at the beginning and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed it later. This is briefly the basic outline of this hadith, and the basic conclusion of this hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the obligatory or offering prayers in jama'ah as obligatory. There is another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam which follows it. This is hadith number 61 of Umdat al-Ahkam. And amazingly, this hadith talks about a woman seeking permission of her husband to go to the masjid. And this hadith, the relationship between this hadith and the previous one is that when it was mandated or made obligatory that jama'ah is essential for male, a question is raised, is it also obligatory for women? So the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab was also included or at the end of the previous hadith. The hadith number 61 reads as follows. And Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma an an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qaal idha sta'dhanat ahadakum imra'atuhu ila al-masjid fala yamna'ha. Qala faqala Bilal ibn Abdullah wallahi la namna'hunna. Qala fa aqbala alayhi Abdullah فسبه سبا سيئا ما سمعته سبه مثله قط وقال أخبرك عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وتقول والله لنمنعهن وفي لفظ لا تمنعوا إماء الله مساجد الله. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, who reported the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, blessings and peace of Allah be upon him, as saying, when the wife of any one of you seeks permission to visit the mosque, do not decline. Do not decline. Do not dismiss the permission. Bilal, the son of Abdullah ibn Umar, was attending. He attended the session. So he stood up and said, he proceeded and said, Wallahi, I swear by Allah that I'm going to prevent my wife of going to the masjid. So Abdullah ibn Umar insulted him severely. And he talked to him aggressively. And he said to him, I report to you what the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, while you oppose, saying by Allah, we will indeed deprive them. From this hadith, we have a couple of conclusions, a couple of legal rulings which are very important in our daily life. On the top of them, that the woman has, a man has a right over his woman. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا اسْتَأْذَنَ أَحَدَكُمْ وَمَرَأَتُهُ. When a woman seeks the permission, so it is supposedly to say that a woman cannot leave home. She cannot go to the masjid. She cannot go to any place except after seeking the permission of her husband. According to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah gave leadership to the husband, gave responsibility to the husband. And this is actually concluded through other ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Moreover, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not leave this permission to be misused by the husband. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he knows, said that if a person is requested to be given, to give the permission for his wife, he should actually give it to her. We will stop on this point, inshallah, this episode, and we will explain more about this hadith and the coming hadith, inshallah. I ask Allah to shower His mercy upon all of us and to bring peace to all of us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.